and he worked there for quite a while. And then he said he was going to leave and start his own practice. He was doing workers' compensation law. And so Mr. Skelly said, well, why don't you detach that part from our part of the firm and keep working here, but you'll be on your own. So he did that for a while, and then he and a woman partner left that firm and started their own company. And so they did that for a number of years, and then that partnership broke up, and he had other partners until he retired in 1989. So he worked for 37 years doing that workers' compensation, where he was the attorney for an injured worker. If you got hurt on your job, you fell off of a ladder and broke your ankle, and you couldn't do that kind of work, whatever work it was that you were doing, you couldn't do that anymore, you know, then they have disability, or they train you to do something else, and that sort of thing. So it was a very rewarding profession, but hard work, because you had to do a lot. You don't get paid a lot of money, and you had to do a lot of cases. When he retired, he had 800 cases, active cases, in his files, and then shortly after he retired, the office kind of went kaflooey. They couldn't keep going without him. So,
well, I never knew all that.
Well, you know, you don't sit down and talk about.
I know, my teacher was talking about how you'll be surprised how much you find out, you know, if you just ask a few questions.
Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah. You get somebody like me that starts and won't shut up.
I know, that's good. I like that.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, we had a good life, you know, and now things are very difficult. But we lived carefully. We never, you know, we didn't spend big amounts of money on things. All of our children got educated. We always had a nice house to live in. But we didn't live extravagantly. We didn't buy expensive clothes or big fancy cars and things like that. So we always saved money and invested it, and now we're spending it.
What was my dad like as a teenager?
Well, it's hard to say. You know, he was the oldest of the four and kind of experimental, and he was never a real problem, but, you know, you always worry about your children.
Mm-hmm.
And some of their choices of friends. Although he was pretty good. He had a lot of friends. He was very popular. And, you know, he was active in sports and played baseball on the team at his high school. Good morning. But he didn't want to cut his hair. He had long hair. I mean, really long hair. And he didn't want to cut his hair, so that, and then the position that he played on the team was second base, and the coach's son also wanted to play second base, so guess who played second base? But he played soccer. He was a good soccer player. He got on the all-county, all-star soccer team when he was in high school. And in those days, kids didn't play soccer much. You know, they didn't have all these little kids, 7 years old,
yeah,
playing soccer the way they do now. And he loved music. They used to go to, there was a place called the Fillmore, and they had all these rock bands that used to come, and he liked to do that. And he played the saxophone a little bit, and he loved a couple of Dexter Gordon and a couple of other people who were good saxophone players, and he used to buy their records or listen to them if they came to town and so on. And he had an old car. His grandfather bought a ranch in Farmington, and it had, when the man died, and in the garage was an old truck and an old Chrysler car. And John got the truck, and David got the car. And I think we had to tow them down. I don't think they were running. I think we rented tow equipment and brought them down, and then they worked on them some and had people work on them. And he drove, that was a great big car, a big heavy car, and he drove that for a while, and John had the truck. I don't know what happened to Dan. He got left out in place in the shuffle. So, as I say, you always worry about your kids. They weren't always perfect, but basically, they were good. They had good standards, and most of their friends we liked. But he went away to school to Santa Barbara when he was 18, and he only stayed 2 quarters. And I never did really know. You ask him sometime why he dropped out of school, but he did. And he came back, but he never lived at home after that. He shared a place with Greg Myers in Mill Valley. And, maybe that wasn't then, but anyway, he never really lived at home. And he took off one day, and I'll never forget that day. We were all in tears. Buzz drove him to the city, and he said he was crying when David got out of the car, and he was going to hitchhike, and he was gone for 3 months, and he never called home. He would send a postcard or a note once in a while, but we never knew how to get in touch with him, where he was, and that was very hard. Kimmy's getting our life stories here.
Yeah, that's good. Did they think? Yeah. I'm learning about Daddy.
And so it was very hard, mm-hmm. He went to Colorado, I think he went up into Canada, and he was gone, for a long time. Then he came back and he started going to classes at College of Marin and so on. And he was a good student. He was very smart. We used to kid him when he was in high school because he was in advanced placement. We used to say he was in the Genius Club because they had tested, and those who did really well in the test and who did well in the advanced placement took extra courses. So we knew he could have done anything that he wanted to do, but he wasn't really that motivated for some reason, and maybe there were things that we did wrong. I don't know. It's hard to tell. But, he turned out fine, got a lovely family and a nice wife. And I think he's happy.
Do you remember meeting my mom for the first time?
I'm trying to think.
I think the story was that, if I remember right, he didn't tell her that she was coming to meet you guys. She thought she was going somewhere else. He just said, oh, let's go out somewhere, and then all of a sudden he's like, okay, we're at my parents' house.
Oh,
she didn't know that. That's
no,
what she told me.
No, maybe. I don't remember that.
Maybe she didn't tell you that. She was acting like she knew, but that's what she told me, that she wasn't ready. She didn't know she was having an experience.
Well, and it was hard for her because she hadn't been here that long.
Yeah.
And she wasn't really comfortable with her English. And she's very shy. And we liked her right away. There's no reason we wouldn't like her. She's a very likable person. She was pretty and is pretty. And all you want for your children is that they're going to be happy. And if the person they choose is going to do that for them, then what more can you ask?
I've also heard stories about how when I came back from Austria at 2 years old, you couldn't talk to me.
That was really strange. Because I used to say, gosh, I never thought I'd have a grandchild that I couldn't communicate with.
Yeah.
It was hard, but it didn't take long.
Yeah.
It didn't take long.
It's strange because sometimes when I go to Austria, it just feels like that. I feel like sometimes I wonder, do I even have a language that I can express myself in? Because it's so strange being over there when everything's in German, and it's like, yeah, I know I can understand German and I can speak it okay, but I always feel, a little bit not like everyone else, and it's strange not being able to just say what you want.
Yeah.
With your family that you're so close to, and not being able to just, say whatever you think of.
Well, that's it. You have a basic background in the German, but
yeah.
not... not specific, and they probably feel the same way about their English.
Yeah.
Those that speak English know the basics, but they don't, to carry on a really deep conversation is not that easy. So, well, I think I better make sure I get my checkout. I think I'm supposed to go at noon, and you're going to stay until 2, I guess, so that'll be fine.
I'm going to go get this.
Okay.
Thank you, though, for...
You're welcome, sweetie.
That's very interesting.
Yes. Maybe more than you ever wanted to know.
Hey, this was an answering machine message from Friday, September 14th, 2001.
It's time to speak up for America. The United States of America is the most generous and possibly the least appreciated country in the world. Millions of people have been lifted out of the debris of war and disaster by America. The United States has not only put their armed forces in harm's way to help, but also offered relief and numerous other forms of assistance. Many different agencies and policies, the United States of America has invested billions of dollars into depressed and war-ravaged countries so they can rebuild and pursue their own freedoms. Too many times to mention, we Americans have raced to the aid of people and countries in need because that is what is in our hearts, and we will continue to do so because freedom and the pursuit of happiness is a belief that burns within each and every one of us. Now is the time for Americans to come to the aid of Americans. It is our duty to involve ourselves in anything that will assist with the efforts in New York and Washington, D.C. Give blood. Donate to the Red Cross. Write to someone with your ideas on stopping terrorism or airport safety. The time has come for Americans to help Americans. Please get involved. Stand proud, fellow Americans. God bless you and God bless America. This message is brought to you by Family Funding. Friday, 6:42 p.m.
Hi, Denise. This is CU. I'm Linda from Women's Ministries. It's your turn.